Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. This podcast is going to be about the difference between poor and rich people. Okay, so we're going to go over 5 steps to separate you into one of the two categories, because there's no middle ground, there's no in between. The middle class is made up, okay? There's no mindset for the middle class. And we'll get into the mindset of the middle class, which really shows that it's a poor mindset. All right, so notice how I didn't say the difference between poor and successful people. Success is really just the attainment of a goal. So if you have a goal, let's say to tie your shoes for the first time, you'd be successful if you tied your shoes for that first time. So success does not actually mean monetary, doesn't mean financial success. We're going to talk about financial reasons that separate poor and rich people. And most of it is in the mind, okay? It's the way you think. When you get to a certain level, you're going to realize there's only 2 types of people, and there's only 1 way of thinking that separates those 2 types of people. And we're going to get into that today. So, firstly, let's look at the global GDP for the world. Okay, the world is worth $71 trillion nominal dollars, meaning we can count it and people can pay with that money. $71 trillion. There's 7 billion people in the world. Now, if we divide 71 trillion by 7 billion, that means everyone should have at least $10,000 to spend at birth. As soon as they're born, you're given a check for $10,000. That's your money to do whatever you want to do with it. Now, that should happen for the rest of the world, the whole world as a whole. But in reality, okay, America's the richest country. There's countries who live off of, you know, $300 a year, just poor countries. And why is that, okay? We're going to go over this. Now, Warren Buffett, one of the richest men in the world, said he was ahead of the game when he finished high school because he didn't have debt and he had saved about $10,000 by his graduation. I think maybe he said college. I can't remember if he said college or high school, but by his graduation, he saved up about $10,000 and he didn't have any debt. So this is what separated him from the rest of the people, okay? He was ahead of the game. He didn't let what we're going to talk about now called interest. He didn't let interest fight against him. He let interest fight with him. So first, get from behind the ball, okay? This is the first point. Get from behind the ball. What happens is people take out loans. They take out credit cards, stuff they can't afford, student loans that they think, you know, or, you know, the family or parents didn't save up for their education, so they have to take out loans, blah, blah, blah. All right. So the fact is that interest can either work for you or you can work for interest. I think, yeah, Albert Einstein said the greatest miracle in the world was interest, or what did he say? I forget the wording, but basically interest. Okay. Can't think of the wording that he used. But the point is interest on your money. So let's say you have $100 in the bank, you get 3% a year, all right, let's just say. So by the end of the first year, you're going to have $103. Now that $103 is then going to gain 3% the next year. So you say, okay, 3% of $103, that's about $4. So the next year you have $107 in your bank account, and it keeps adding up. Now that's a small amount, but you can see that even if you had, let's say, $10,000, and you made 3%, or let's say 1,000 and you had 3%. Okay, that 1,000, I can't even count now. It's about, what, $30? 30 times 100? Yeah. I can't count. But the point is, the interest multiplies on itself. All right, and it's working for them. It's not working against them. Now, where does that money come from? Where does that interest come from? It comes from people who take out loans. It comes from people who take out credit cards. It comes from people who get mortgages. Okay, they have to pay interest on the principal or the money, the interest money. They have to pay extra for the thing that they can't buy at full price. So if you can't buy a $30,000 car, you're going to have to take out either a car loan or lease it. And let's say you take out a car loan, okay, for $30,000. You're going to pay more than $30,000 by the end of the car loan. You're going to pay about double that because of interest. Okay, and that's what separates the rich from the poor. It's that the rich have the interest fighting for them. They invest in companies and things where interest, they offer interest basically for people to work for them, because that's what interest is all about. So anyway, let's get back to the point here. There's only two types of people: people who are behind interest and people who are ahead of interest. So that's the financial separation between the rich and the poor currently. Now, I'm not saying don't take out loans and don't think credit is terrible, because when you use credit and you use it to profit or you add more value to the money, that's different. Okay. Now, if you've noticed in those music magazines where they sell a lot of hardware and gear and software, you're going to notice that there's two options. You can either pay full price or you can pay a long-term price through a payment plan, considered layaway or considered credit, whatever it may be. But it's a long-term payment plan. And if you notice, if you calculate the payment plan, let's say Omnisphere sells for flat out $500, or you could pay, I think, maybe $20 a month for maybe, let's see, 20-something months. So, about 3 years payments worth for $20 a month, that adds up to more than $500 in the long term. So they're getting more money out of you when you pay long term. And a lot of people think, okay, I have a credit card, let me buy stuff I can't afford, and then it's going to rack up over time. But they think, okay, it's a small payment now. They think, okay, I can afford $20 a month. Rather than thinking long term, I'm going to be down $600-something because, I didn't want to save up $500 to get Omnisphere. So the point is, instead of using credit to use it as a retail, using credit for retail, I suggest never to use credit for retail. Meaning, if you're going to use credit just for stuff that your pleasure, like a TV, Xbox, stuff that just won't increase your value as a company and a business, just don't even, entertain the idea of buying retail on credit. Okay. Now there's things where you buy credit, but you're making an investment. You're saying, okay, if I buy this $2,000, Native Instruments, like Ultimate, what's it called? Complete, but for $1,000. But if I get a credit card or whatever and pay $50 a month, I can turn that $1,000 purchase into, my business, and my business is worth however much the business is worth. So you're making a tremendous amount of money, more than you would if you were to just, if you didn't have the money right away. So if you didn't have $1,000 right away, you would make tons more if you just used credit and worked the credit. Okay, it's a difference. You have to beat out interest. You have to go above and beyond interest in order to be profitable if you ever take out credit. So that was the boring part of this presentation, but we put it first to get it out the way. And the point here is that you need to practice discipline. Okay, there's this thing about us that we want to spend. We're just a consumer society. And I've been in the place where you get a check, okay, you save up a little bit, and then you spend it, and then you get addicted to spending. You get addicted to having the option to spend. And basically what happens is you're going to tip over the board. You're going to start spending before you even get the money. You're going to have things you want to buy before you get your next paycheck. And that's where you're really behind the ball, and you're starting to really overly consume more than you're actually getting. So that's a terrible thing that you need to practice your discipline with. Save first and then spend. You're going to notice, okay, we have monetary goals now. Let's say we want to save up $1,000 for whatever. The first $1,000, when I get that $1,000, I'm going to be so happy, blah, blah, blah. We have this image of money that's like, okay, when I get my first $100,000, I'm done, And when I get my first $1,000,000, I'm done. But in reality, when you're getting that money, it's just a number. At the end of the day, it really just becomes a number, because there's two situations with money. There's survival. There's an attitude about money where you're thinking, okay, I have to survive. I have to get this money. And you're just focused on survival. That's the lowest level of getting money or financially sustaining yourself. Because you're just thinking about bills. You're thinking, okay, I just need enough to get this bill. Once I get enough, I'm done. And then you start it over for another month, and you only make up to the amount of the bill. And once you get past the survivor mode, and we're going to get into the ways you can get past that survivor mode, you're going to get into, okay, I'm past the survival thing. I know I'm fine for a long time. Okay, I'm getting a lot of money, but, you know, the $1,000 I thought that was going to be the end-all be-all is just a number now. It's like, okay, I can get a $1,000 check and be like, okay, it's just a number to the bank account. It really just becomes a number. And this is why, you know, we're going to get into it in another podcast, but this is why businesses need to have purposes and they need to have missions behind the business. And they need to do other things like invest in other things, but we're not going to get into that. The point, again, the first point is practice discipline, because it's ultimately there to give us more freedom. So the discipline here would be to get from behind the ball of interest, get from behind, you know, paying ahead, get from behind, you know, falling behind so much interest and extra costs. Okay. So again, practicing discipline will ultimately give us more freedoms. For example, I got a puppy not too long ago, and he naturally just likes to chew on a lot of things. So what I had to do was kind of puppy proof the floor so he doesn't chew up everything. Now, let's say I teach him how to stay or teach him how to leave something on the floor that's not supposed to be on the floor. I'm doing that because I don't want him to choke and die on the thing, first off. And also I'm doing it because if he listens to me, I won't have to put him in the crate or put him in timeout all the time. I can let him more freely go around and do what he wants to do if he just listens to me now. And people don't understand that. They think discipline is just to put you in a box, in a cage. In reality, learning the laws and learning the discipline behind business, which is really just the obtaining of wisdom. It takes a lot of wisdom to, you know, make a business thrive. And people don't, you know, they don't understand that. Obtaining of wisdom is really what business is all about. But, you know, once you get disciplined, then you're going to have more freedoms. Then you're going to be trusted with more open areas. You're going to be trusted to walk around the house and not chew up on everything. All right. So his natural gene for discovering things, you know, what makes him happy, finding things on the floor. Now I can trust him to know that he's not going to eat them or anything. So I let him explore more. I open up the house to him. So that's what discipline is all about. A little metaphor. Now, the second point here is the law of the seed. Now we're going to start talking about universal laws that are just that dictate the universe. So, like I said, once you gain discipline and you start to follow the laws and work with the law, you're going to have more freedom at the end of the day rather than fighting against the laws. So the second point here in what separates the poor from the rich is the law of the seed. Okay, so you're going to hear this in a lot of religion and a lot of, you know, Christian background, especially because the Messiah taught a parable about this. So now we're not going to make it religious and corny. That's another thing. Religion kind of made a lot of wisdom and a lot of truth very corny, so the typical guy won't go after it. Whether that's a security thing or whatever it is, it seems like churches tend to change the terminology to only focus on their community when it should be targeted to the average person. But anyway, law of the seed. So what does this mean? All right, so it means rich people seek to give more to who needs it. Okay, that's the American way to understand this. Rich people seek to give more to who needs it and who wants it. That should be also be in there. Who needs it and who wants it. Rich people seek to give more to who needs it. Keyword is give, okay? Now, poor people scheme and plot how to get the most stuff. Poor people scheme and plot how to get the most stuff, whereas rich people seek to give more to who needs and want it. Now, you've heard of stories where people drive to McDonald's, get coffee spilled on their lap, sue McDonald's for $12 million, okay? That's a poor mindset. If you were rich, you wouldn't even entertain the idea of suing for that much money. You don't go out looking for insurance frauds or how to jump in front of a car and sue somebody. You don't go out thinking you're going to hit the lottery. Okay, the chances of hitting the lottery are worse than getting struck by lightning twice or whatever the stats are, I forget. Okay, so, you know, poor people think they have to get the most. They go out, they get all the free stuff offered by the, you know, wherever, the hotels and the big corporations, and they think they have to just get everything, whereas rich people give more. So it's not, just to understand the world is not a finite place. We're not dependent on earthly resources as much as we were before. Okay, the gold rush, you know, just think about the gold rush. The way money was it was actually a physical thing. So people went out to the West to physically capture as much gold as possible so they could sell it and become rich. Whereas nowadays, you can become rich with a computer in your room with a software program on it. You don't have to go out and look for a physical thing to become rich anymore. And we talked about this in another video, another podcast, about how the world is going towards the digital. It's not, you know, the physical is still here, but it's moving towards the digital or the spiritual. And that's in another podcast, the unseen. So the point here is you don't have to go seek out gold to be rich anymore. Okay. The world has a finite amount of resources, whereas our minds, our intellect, our personality, our wealth inside, we have the power to make the world billions and billions of times over rich. Whereas the world itself can only be rich so much because it's limited. Okay, so anyway, we're not in a finite world is the point there. Now, finding energy and water are still big issues, but we have moved as a society away from hard labor to white-collar labor. And this is what separates America from the rest of the world. A lot of people wonder, okay, why don't they have factories in America? Why, why are they taking away all the jobs, et cetera, et cetera? And the point is, we're moving towards becoming more bosses. Everybody in America typically should be the head of a company. We should all be entrepreneurs and have the rest of the world do the hard work. Our job is not to do hard work anymore. We're out of the industrial era. We're in the modern era where hard work does not determine your success or your financial stability. Okay, you could work hard all day and make 10 times less than a guy who sits in his office, makes a couple decisions, creates something, and you know, you're still making less even though you're working super hard. I remember having a lot of physical jobs, where I was underappreciated, where I worked super harder than everybody else because they were too lazy, where, you know, just extra hard work for no reason, and I was getting paid the same amount as they were. So why work hard when you can work smart? And that's the key, working smarter, not harder. And we're going to get into those and how to sell Beats, the product. So when it comes out, you're going to understand how to work smarter, not harder. Okay. You don't need to work hard to get paid. You must work smarter and think. That's the key word. You must work smarter and think. You have to use your mind. We went over in one podcast, hypnotic rhythm and what the world is versus the chosen people or the people who separate themselves from the world who ultimately want to gain the desires of the creator. And those are the people who use their mind, who renew their mind so that it's clean of this worldly ego. And, you know, we think more, we give more, and we're in the eternal relationship. We'll get into all that eventually. Now, that's a lot to take in, but let's move on. But Einstein said, imagination is more important than knowledge, okay? Einstein, one of the most brilliant people of his time, said, imagination is more important than knowledge. Okay, knowledge is just the knowing of something. Like, I know grass is green, that's knowledge. Whereas if I imagined grass being purple, I would come up with a system to change that grass into purple. Imagination can change your reality. Okay, to make it more than what it is. So, again, this is the second point, which is plant your seed. Okay, whether your seed is your energy or a free thing that you give away, a free product of yours for your company that you give away in a place where it will flourish. What does that mean? Plant your energy or your free thing that you give away into the right market, in front of the right people. And once it starts to grab hold of the people in the market like it would soil, it will start to grow, okay? So it took me 8 beat tapes to even get noticed. It took a lot of seeds for me to get noticed. And, you know, I did each beat tape a little bit differently. Some were on DatPiff, some were hosted with Hipstrumentals, some were on GotInstrumentals.com. you know, I planted those in different areas, those different seeds, and it took eight beat tapes to even begin to get noticed on the internet. It took me 8 products to get my business rolling. Okay, 8 is just a weird number with my company. And, you know, spiritually, the understanding of 8 is the number of new beginnings. So maybe after 8, we see a new beginning. I don't know. But so my point here, it takes time for a seed to grow. So keep planting your seeds. Keep planting your energy, your products, your beats, your beat tapes. Keep putting those in front of people who want them and need them. And in the right market, in front of the right people, for as long as you can. Keep doing it. Keep planting seeds all around the year. Okay. Because it takes time for a seed to grow. And if you keep planting, eventually you're going to get a harvest at some point. Okay. And I have an example where, you know, I put out beat tapes, you know, about almost a year ago. People were contacting me for beats I had out almost, you know, a year ago. And they're old in my eyes, but to other people, it's brilliance. And it got to the right person. You know, the harvest pulled up out of the, well, the spiritual earth, I guess you could say. So let's move on. But hopefully you get the idea. So same thing here. This podcast will fall on tons of ears. Tons of people will hear this podcast around the world. Some people will reject this podcast for whatever reason and reject the truth. Some won't understand it, and others will prosper from the new mindset that they gain from listening to this podcast. So, you know, there's different results for the different people that see this podcast, whether it's in video or audio form, or hear this podcast. So, you know, depending on who it lands on, it might not grow for the person who doesn't understand it. And this is considered a seed out to the world. So I have notes here that I'm trying to follow, and I wrote the wrong word. It says me wetting is seasonal. I don't know what that means. Me wetting is seasonal. You plant in spring and reap in fall. So I guess you could say business is seasonal, okay? You plant, I guess it would say the world. The world is seasonal. You plant in spring and you reap in the fall. And this is important when you understand the difference between your seeds. And when they start to harvest, you'll understand this a lot better. So I have some videos that have 100,000 views. I have videos that have under 1,000 views. Some catch on, some don't. Okay, that's the seed. Whether it grows or not depends on whether it landed in the right place. So since the world is seasonal, since business is seasonal, you plant in the spring, okay, so you don't see any growth yet, you reap in the fall. Now, when you reap, you have to reap, get the most out of it. When it's harvest time, you know, for example, if you have videos on YouTube, you put a video out every day, one catches on, one has 100,000 views, you have to take advantage of the fall season. Okay, you have to say, okay, on that 100,000 view video, let me add some annotations to go to another video. Let me add links in the description so people can click to go visit something else. You know, you have to take advantage of your wins. You're only going to have a few. It's the 80-20 rule. 80%, I forget, let me think. Let's see. 80-20 rule says that only 20% are going to be winners out of the whole 100%. So you can have 80% failures, but have those 20% that make up for the 80% that don't work. So, you know, it's just like investment, just like business, just like anything else. You're going to have a few winners and have a lot of quote unquote failures, but they're not really failures. But you're going to have a few winners that are considered harvests, and you have to make sure you take full advantage of those. Now, thirdly, moving into the third aspect of what separates rich from poor people is disbelief and lack of action. So with poor people and people who just don't follow truth at all, is that they are just talkers and they don't do. There's no action involved. Nike has the best, you know, trademark is just do it. Now, I would suggest thinking before you just do it, because not every action is a good action, but you know, you need to act at some point. And action is what separates people who just have dreams and plans versus people who actually, you know, implement the dream and the plan into the real world. So again, don't be a talker. You know, if you're going to do anything, at least prove it by doing it. Don't just say you're going to do it and say, you know, blah, blah, blah. Nobody cares about what you say. They care about what you do. So anyway, disbelief and lack of action. So if you don't believe you can make $2,000 a month selling beats, you won't, period. And I'll tell you why. It's because I used to think my beat prices were too high when they were very low. Let's say, what was the beat price I used to charge? I think $75 exclusive, and maybe, I can't remember the lease. Maybe it was like $19.90, just the average price for a lease, okay? I used to think that the exclusive was so high that nobody would want to buy it. Now, there's different parameters on how to estimate price, and we're going to get into that in a course that's not available yet, but it will be available in the link below. But the point here is that, what was I saying? I lost track when I... Okay, the exclusive price that I thought nobody would buy for, you know, people buy for way more than that. They buy for 100 times more than what I was charging. They buy beats for $7,500 on a daily basis. And it's because, you know, there's levels of thinking. You know, when you run a business and when your business is successful, you think, okay, something has value. Like, let's say for my business, let me think of something where I can explain this. Never mind. Well, let's just say there's some service out there in the world that's worth $200 that I really need. So I say, okay, $200, that's really nothing to what that service can do value-wise for my company. I know if I spend the $200 now, you know, my company's going to make 100% more than what I've been making before. So, you know, that's how you have to look at, you have to look at the buyer's side of the view when you set your prices for your beats, especially. Because you're not, a lot of producers don't think in the artist side. They're thinking on their side. They're thinking, okay, this is too much. I wouldn't buy this. And that's because you're not an artist making money on the road touring. If you're making money on the road touring and doing different musical projects and different opportunities, and you're making money doing it, $200 is like, you know, it's necessary. It's a necessary investment for your next project. So, you know, thinking $200 is a lot for an exclusive is just, a lot of people just don't comprehend that, you know, successful businesses don't think with a lackful mindset. They don't think in the, that's a lot of money. Like, you know what I mean? They think in the, I prosper now and I'm going to flip this $200 expense into $20,000. Okay. So you have to think in the artist's shoes in order to really understand how to price your beats. And we're going to get into a system in which you can learn how to price your beats and everything else. But for now, it's to get over the disbelief and the lack of your action. So again, you can make $2,000 a month selling beats. That should be really the minimum to start out with. $2,000 a month really adds up to $24,000 a year. And I think the poverty level in America is around $22,000 to $24,000 a year. So that's the poverty line in America. So, you know, $2,000 a month really is not much. So thinking about that, you know, you have to get over that. And that's because we have disbelief because you never experienced it. So, I meant to add another anecdote is that when I was selling beats thinking the exclusive price was so high, it was hard selling beats because I had that mindset. I thought it was too high and I never did the right thing to sell it to the right person. Now, also, I was super excited selling my first beat. I remember I sold the first beat. I was just way too excited. Like, I sold a typical lease for about $20 or whatever. And I was just super excited because it never happened before. And I would have never understood that experience unless it would have happened. And I believed I could sell a lease, but I didn't believe the exclusive would be sold because I thought it was too high. And that's the difference there. So my point here is that faith, or the act of believing, is the only thing that can bridge the gap for experiences that you've never had. And that means, I think it was Aristotle or Socrates, one of the two, has a prisoner example. They're famous philosophers for the old time. And they have a prisoner example where prisoners are locked up in a cave underground and there's a fire behind the prisoners. So I think they're looking forward. They're all looking towards this wall. And they're all locked up so they can't move. And there's a fire behind them. And all they see is moving shadows. So they think the world, they think their world is just a bunch of moving shadows. Whereas they're in a cave underground and there's a real world above them. Okay. So the question that one of the philosophers asked was, how can they know of the truth of the world above them? How can they escape this cave and understand the world above them? And the only solution to that is faith, because you have to just believe that there's more. You have to believe that there's a beyond, because you've never experienced the real world or the real prosperity. That was the abundance, the metaphor for abundance in that example, the prisoner example, because they're locked underground in a cave, seeing shadows from a fire behind them. And that's all they understand. That's all they've experienced. They've never experienced going above ground. And the only way they can go above ground is to imagine and believe that there is an above ground, okay? That there is more than what they're seeing. That's the only way. They can't physically go up there. They can't, you know, see it. So that's the only way they can actually get above ground. Now, that's a very deep philosophy. You can go study it or look it up. It's called The Prisoner's Example. I think it's Socrates. I think we studied a lot of Socrates, so I think it was Socrates. Anyway, so faith is the only thing that bridges the gap. I think I'm missing a crucial element in that example. I think someone came down and told them there was a world above, but they didn't believe it or something like that. Anyway, so another more common example is, again, my puppy. Okay, before I got my puppy, I was weighing out pros and cons like crazy, like vet costs, food. I was just making it really like a financial thing. Like, is the dog, am I going to be happy financially after I get a dog or am I not? I was just basing it on finance. Whereas when I got the dog, it was a complete, you just can't calculate what you experience for something you've never experienced before. And of course, my dog brings joy and everything else to me to keep me happier throughout the day. And I, you know, we're best buds. So that's my dog. And the point here is I couldn't add that in the pros and cons list. I can't judge my happiness because I've never experienced it yet. I can't judge the joy I'm going to get because I don't know what I'm going to experience. And that's key. You have to have faith in your decisions. Okay. Faith that there's more. Now, fourthly, what separates rich people from poor people is taking responsibility. You know, at the job, like I mentioned before, I used to have a job where I worked super hard and the other guys would just work really sluggishly and wouldn't do much at the job. And I would be doing the, you know, the bulk of the work. And that's because they never took responsibility for their work. And the majority of their issues, they would have issues with the manager, issues with different policies that changed throughout the course of time. And they never took responsibility. They would blame stuff on other people. They would, you know, blame their results on something else. Like, I didn't perform today because the customers weren't coming in. You know, just stuff that they blamed it on. And that's because they didn't take responsibility. And when you're an entrepreneur, which every producer nowadays is, unless you work under, you know, a label directly, excuse me, and under a record label, you know, every beatmaker is really an entrepreneur. You're a business owner. You're a business owner who creates value that never existed before. That's who you are. You're a person who creates value out of thin air, and you create a business and offer value to other people who can then offer value to another set of people who then offer value to, it's a circle. Okay. And you're an entrepreneur. So you need to realize that first off the bat. And entrepreneurs work off of results. They're not based in security. See, what jobs offer is security. What jobs offer is a steady paycheck every week, every month that says, okay, this is how much you're going to make for the rest of your life, unless you do something to get a raise or whatever, unless you take a pay cut or whatever. So that's what jobs are for, security. Okay. There's a set value in this, a certain task in this company that we can offer this amount of money for. If you can do it, fine, you get the money. If not, you're fired or you take a pay cut. So, but entrepreneurs work the opposite. They say, okay, how much value can I give this month? Or no, they say, how much do I need to, you know, keep things alive in a business? How much value can I offer? And, you know, they say, let me do it. And they measure the results and they say, how can I do this better? They do it better. They measure the results. They're getting better results. And it gets better and better as an entrepreneur because you take responsibility for your actions and you can measure your results. Whereas if you were in a corporation, you made a mistake in the marketing, you could lose the company $50,000 easily, you know, and then blame it on one of the 1,000 employees that the corporation has. Whereas when you're working as an entrepreneur, you have to take all the results on yourself. If you fail, you fail. If you succeed, period. And that's it. That's the reality of it. And when you get in that mindset, you can begin to use all the rest of the disciplines to then fulfill or help thrive your business. So that you're not thinking about security. You're beyond security. You're then getting into how can I give more? You're getting past that survival mode that we spoke about, and you're getting into the how can I give more, into the mission side of things. So fifthly, what separates rich people from poor people is service, serving, okay? Serving. If you believe in a creator of the universe, which I do, and I believe everyone should, it's clearly obvious if you look at the macro world, the micro world, if you look under a microscope, same principles lie in the macro world, okay? It's universal disciplines. And the fact that people can take an idea out of their mind and manifest it into reality, like the guitar I'm sitting in front of, the fact that somebody thought of a guitar, built it together, and it exists, shows that the guitar was in your mind the whole time. It was in this consciousness. It was in this unseen idea, okay? And that idea, the blueprint of reality, is, you know, the essence there is proof enough that there's more than what people even understand. Anyway, so the point here is to serve, okay? And when you serve others, you're ultimately serving the creator, the Lord, okay? You're serving the creator when you serve others. Now, that was a big eye-opener when I first started, you know, business. I didn't really understand, you know, like I said, a lot of religion like to use cool words like ministry and, you know, what are some other words? I'll just use the word ministry, like the, what is it called? The youth ministry or some other word ministry. Okay. The word ministry just means to serve. Like, I don't even know why they use the word minister. It's confusing. It just means to serve. So you can minister to your friend by serving them food, by helping them with their math problems. You could serve your friends by, you know, fixing their car. Okay, there's a lot of ways you can serve others. And the fact that the eternal relationship, what I like to say is the eternal relationship, one gives and another gives back. Okay, and I can go into depth in that if you would like in another video. But basically, it's an eternal relationship that defines reality as we know it. And the point here is you need to serve in order to, you know, make your business successful. You have to serve. You have to go out and say, how can I serve these people instead of serving yourself? And here's where a lot of producers fall. They put their ego before themselves, and all they do is make music that they like, music that is good to their ears. And they just put it up, and those are the type of people who want to show off their music to everybody because they're so serving themselves. They want to put up their SoundCloud or put up their links in places they're not supposed to be. They'll advertise on YouTube videos because they're that desperate for attention because they're ultimately not serving anyone but themselves. And they just want people to focus on them because they're serving themselves. Whereas people who actually serve don't need to go out and spam people 1,000 times on YouTube or go out and constantly post everything to Instagram, every little thing that you do in the studio, because you're getting over an ego. And we're going to get into that in another section. So again, serve. It's very simple. Just find out who needs something, serve them, and boom. That's where money comes from. That's where value comes from. That's where business comes from. It's everything. So just serve others. It's as simple as that. So those are the five keys which separate rich and poor people. And we can go into more depth in all of these, and there's more. But again, it's tons of wisdom in business. It's just tons. And we're going to reveal more and more as we go. So thanks for listening. It's busyworksbeats.com. Again, you can click that link below for our new product on how to make your beat business thrive. So if you want to learn how to actually make good income with your beat business, you need to click that link below. And when the product comes out, it's going to be a super bomb for the industry. We're going to change everybody's mindset, and we're going to become true business owners and true winners. So thanks for listening today. It's busyworksbeats.com.